Okay, so now chapter 2. Worked out just right, man. Chapter 1 was finished right in time. Chapter 2. My little children. So I wasn't even finished. Well, I suppose I was. Okay. Chapter 2. My little children, I write these things to you that you may not sin. He's not saying that you may not sin, the sin nature, that you may not participate in the sin. He's talking about the sin. And listen, and if anyone may sin, as in Freemason, if anyone may sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Yeshua the Anointed, a righteous one, or the righteous one. He's talking about overcoming the sin, like Paul talks about in Romans 6, verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in the sin? Most High forbid, verse 2. How shall we that have died to the sin continue therein anymore? Once we know the truth, we've died to it. We don't go back participating, talking that old talk, speaking that old language out of our mouth, putting ourselves back under the law of Moses, telling everybody to love their neighbors as themselves, and love the Most High with all our heart, soul, strength, mind, and everything else that has to do with the law of Moses. Right? We've died to that. Right? John ain't talking about the sin nature here. My little children, write these things that you may not sin. And if anyone may sin, we have an advocate with the Father, the Father Yeshua the Anointed, the righteous one. And he is an atoning sacrifice for the sin. And of course that includes our sin nature too, right? He atoned for the sin. The priority is the sin, the works of our own hand, convincing ourselves that we can attain unto the commandments of the Most High. Trying to be like the Most High, that's called the sin, trying to be like the Most High. Satan did that. He committed that. The sin, he tried to be like the Most High. He wanted to depose him off his throne. So he gathered a third of the angels with him to go to war with the Most High. The Most High flicked him off his finger like a booger as fast as lightning and cast him to the earth because of the sin. Okay. Now also he forgives us of our sin nature too, so whenever we do commit a sin, right, he does forgive us of our sin nature too. Alright. Okay. And not only, okay, so he is an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Right? And once it's done, it's done. We don't have to keep confessing it over and over and over again. Right? Once we confess that we were participating in the sin, we don't have to really confess it. Confess, that word confess is just the word coming to agreement with in our minds, silently within our thinking. We make a decision, right? And so we automatically just start thinking right now. We agree with what the truth is about the sin. And that's done. One time it's over. We don't have to confess it every day. It's done. Okay, we know, and as far as the sin nature go, we know when our sin nature, we know it's bad, but we also know it's always going to be there. You know, we're not proud of it, right? But there's nothing we can do to get rid of it. You know. But if you know, on the other hand, if we're just all in all and all out and out, you know, just you know, just you know. just sin on purpose, just do all we can do, you know, on purpose, just for the heck of it, you know. then we might feel a little bad about it, right? We might want to feel a little bit bad about that. and the Most High would be a little bit grieved with us, right? But when we're operating under the truth and we're out from under the law of Moses, that we're out from under the power of the sin, and so our sin nature isn't fed like the regular guy, and so we do actually sin less. You know, it's not a big thing anymore. We're not having to prove anything to anybody in society, in a church, and this and that. Everybody goes to church and they have to put on their goodness, their good suits, their good attitudes, and everything's good and everything's dandy and dandy. It's all a front. And so they're trying so hard to look good. They're trying so hard to look good. Always trying so hard to look good. And it's actually grinding them to powder. We don't have that problem. We ain't trying to look good. Anyway, he's the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And not only for ours, but also for the whole world. Right? Now he's not talking about everyone, because not everyone's going to come into salvation. In fact, the Most High created some on purpose to go to destruction. And he did that so that you know, there'll be an example of his fair punishment, knowing through all eternity. Oh yeah, commit the sin, punished. Okay. So when he says the whole world, he's talking in general, you know. Those throughout the whole world that I have called before the foundations of the earth. I knew before they were born that they were going to make a decision for me. In fact, I put it in them to make them make a decision for me. He is the source of everything. Okay. And in this we know that we have known him. And in this, with this knowledge, this is how we know that we know him. All right? When we finally come to the grips and the realization of what the truth is, this is how we know him.
There's an end part to it. And this is how we know that we know him. If his commands we may keep.
Is he talking about the law of Moses commandments? No. The new commands. He gave us two new commands. John is talking about the new commandment. And we're going to get into this because he's going to say it point blank. And it sounds kind of confusing, right? But it takes a mature man to understand.
It's kind of like Peter wrote a letter. Peter wrote a letter and he says,
Paul writes a lot of things that are hard to understand. He's talking about Paul, right?
Well, when we're reading John too, it's a little bit hard to understand.
But with the proper teaching and guidance, it's easy. The big picture is easily seen. It's everything's about the sin. Everything. And the sin is putting ourselves under the commandments, the law. Trying to be like the Most High.
So he's talking about the new commands here.
And this we know, that we have known him, if his commands we keep.
And so we're walking in love now, loving our brother. We love our brother by speaking the truth to him. We're all communicating the truth to one another. Right? He who is saying, I have known him, and is not keeping his command, he is a liar. And the truth is not in him. Woo!
And whoever may keep his word, truly the love of the Most High has been perfected in him. Now he's talking about what real perfection is.
Striving to love our neighbors as ourselves is striving after a perfection that cannot be attained. But putting ourselves under the new commands, the new commandment, a new command I give unto you, he says, love your brother. Anybody that does this is now become perfected in him. Perfected. The early church. Remember we went over that in Ephesians? Okay. I talked about in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. That was in part. And when that is perfect has come. Right? What was known in part is the Old Testament. It wasn't clear what's going on. But now that the New Testament's here, the perfect, the old is done away with. That what's in part, that we knew in part, little parts here and there, is now made perfect. Now we have a full understanding. That's how we're made perfect. And that was the bringing together of the early church to perfect them. And gifts were given to bring in the knowledge that the Holy Spirit put into each man, you know, as the apostles taught everybody. And then the Holy Spirit, according to each man's gift, would give him a revelation. And they'd say, hey, look, here's something, a new perspective on the sin. Here's what the sin describes. Okay? And it describes one thing. And we don't look within ourselves to come up with our own testament. There's one testament. The only testament that was given by Yeshua and taught by Apostle Paul and the other 11 apostles. One testament. There's no testament that we get within ourselves. Each one has his own testament. Alright. And whoever may keep his word, truly the love of the Most High has been perfected in him. In this we know that we are in him. And this is how we know that we are in him. When we know this knowledge so good, we become established and firm, confident, assured, fully wise, understanding men, walking the earth. Real wisdom. This is wisdom. It's the wisdom that gets us our eternal life. All right? He, verse 6 of chapter 2, 1 John, he who is saying he does remain in him should also walk as according he walked. Okay? He's not talking about the parables as though we're supposed to follow his parables. Everybody looks at his parables. Oh, his parables, the parables are describing the Christian life. No, he's talked about the new command. He was speaking truth. He walked, his walk was a walk of truth. He spoke the truth. Okay, when he spoke about those commandments, he was speaking the truth about them. Those commandments are there to show a man they can't do them. And he was speaking to Israel, a nation of Israel, who put themselves under the law of Moses and convinced themselves they were performing them good enough to get their eternal life. And he was speaking these parables to them to show them that they can't perform them. He was speaking the truth. So we should speak the same thing that he spoke about those parables, about the law of Moses. The same thing. Walk as he walked. This is walking in love when we speak the truth to one another. Brethren, I write you not a new command unto you. In other words, he's saying, this new commandment is nothing new. I've already explained it to you. I'm writing you a letter now. A follow-up letter from the explanation when I visited you and formed your little church. 1 John, you know, or a church that Paul started. You know, he says, I'm not writing anything new to you. You know, the new commandment is old news. It's been around a while now.